Record starting already. Yes, you are recording, and then you may easily see what's happening there. All right, so let's start. Today, our second online meeting, and we are going to talk about today. We are going to start to talk about arrays, and after that, I'm going to mention about classes. I've just mentioned already in the classroom, and maybe after that, how can we create an object? How can we use, stack and heap possibilities? We will see all details while we are just talking about. Now, because I am going to talk, but you don't need to see me, you must see the notes. That's why I'm going to switch the camera to the other one, and you can easily see what's going to happen. So I think you can see the paper, and my question is if it is okay by this way for you. For example, if I write here array, can you be able to read properly? One of you can say yes or no, is going to be enough. If you read it, yes, okay. So if it is going to be read by properly by yourself, so it's going to be very nice, very good. All right, we are talking about array. What is array? When we talk about array, if there are some variables which can be used regularly, continuously, generally we are using array. For example, let's say we are going to have five numbers. Normally for five numbers in our program, we could say integer. For example, A1 is the first number, comma, A2 is the second number, comma, A3 is the third number, comma. As you see, if we just carrying on like this, as you see, all of them are like different variables. If we need numbers, which is called A, and if we just give them some names like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, so as you see here, there are five variables. Okay, so let us guess, let us know that in RAM, our RAM is here, as you know. Here we are going to have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, A1, A2, A3, A4, and A5. These are the RAM occupation for those variables, and all of them are, as you know, 4 bytes. Okay, 4 bytes. So at the end of the day, they are all called A, but A1, A2, A3, A4, A5. So as you see, you have to write by putting comma for each of them. So then later on, you can say A1 is equal to 7. What's going to happen? 7 is going to come here. If you say, for example, A2 is equal to 3, 3 is going to come here. So now, for the numbers, let's say these are the marks. These are the marks for the students. Do I have 5 students only? Of course not. I have 150 students, right? So then what am I going to do? I will continue here, A6, A7, like this, A150. Which is not useful, which is not a good idea to use variables this way. So what are we going to do now? We are going to learn array. So how are we going to use it? How are we going to use it? If we have such kind of variable which can be used for the same purpose, like integer variable, and a huge amount of number. What's going to happen is very easy to use. We are going to write the variable name, variable data type, which is integer. And we are going to put here brackets. These brackets, what's going to happen is saying that now we are creating an array. So then we say integer variable, integer array A. Okay, so after that we can just say equal to new integer, and I say 5 here. So what's happening now? Okay, wait, I had a message. It's seen very difficult way. I just have to make it bigger. The screen. Wait, I must change how to make it. Hold on a sec, please. Because one of your friends said that it's difficult to see. All right. Is there anyone who knows how to make it like full screen? I'm just checking at the moment. I will just, sorry to keep you waiting. Technical problem. To make it off. No way. Okay, I couldn't find it. So can we carry on like this way? Because I don't know how to make a full screen this, I mean my screen on the screen only. And the quality is bad. You mean the video quality? Okay, let me try to make the letters bigger. Maybe from that point we can just see better. All right, I'm just going to write this part again. For example, integer a is equal to new integer 5. Is it better? Okay, I'm going to use like a bigger letter. So let's do this way. Okay, let me just carry on here. Let me just carry on here. These brackets are saying that this A is an array. So like the previous one, instead of using A1, A2, A3, A4, A5, instead of this one, we created an array, which is here, integer array A, new integer 5. So what does it mean? In our RAM, like the previous one again, in our RAM, we do have an A. This is A. Okay, all of them are A. And starting from 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. So we have 5 places for A because we write here 5. And they have an index number. You must never forget. You must never forget. In computer engineering, in computers, index numbers are starting from 0. So that's why the first one is 0. Second one is 1, 2, 3, 4. So look at the index number. The maximum index number is 4. Maximum index number is 4. Minimum index number is 0. But how many variable or not variable? How many spaces we have for the integer A. So as you see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Why? Because we write here 5. How do you call them? So in programming, you call them A0, for example. So you could say A0 is equal to 7. What happens in the 0th position? This 7 appears here. You could say A3. What happens? A3 is, let's say, it's equal to 4. What happens? It comes to this part, 4. So as you see, A0 is 7, A3 is 4, and you can just play with those numbers. All right. So let us carry on next step for the array. What is our next step? For example, user is going to enter five numbers, and we are going to add those five numbers. So normally, user is going to enter five numbers. User enters five numbers. So we are going to create integer. It's an array. And for numbers, I use n variable. So I say there is an n. How many numbers do we have? Five numbers. New. The type of is the same. The type of the n is the same. Integer. How many? I say five numbers. Okay. So user is going to enter five numbers. So do we know how many numbers are going to enter? Five. Is it going to be regularly entered? Yes. So do we know? So then what can we use here? We can use a loop here. So which loop is better? Because we know how many numbers of the loop is going to happen. It's going to be five. That's why for loop is the best idea to use here. For loop is very good. For loop is the best idea to be able to use. And for the for loop, we have parentheses, as you know. And we have three parameters. The first parameter is initial value, integer I. All the time, you may remember, we used I. I stands for index. That's why we use I in general. So this time, you must be careful for the for statement. All the time, we must start from the zero, okay? Because index are starting from zero. So the second option is going to be, second parameter is going to be the condition. This I will continue while it is less than 5. You see this 5, the number of array. So while I is less than 5, which means that if it is 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, it will happen. Let's carry on. I++. So this loop is going to happen from 0 to 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay. So what's going to happen? We are going to read n. Okay, pay attention here. I'm not leaving n as it is. I'm putting here n, I. So as you see here, n, I means. First of all, it's going to be n0. Secondly, n1. Thirdly, n2. N3, n4. So then this way, what's going to, I'm just writing here read. You could say like console write line, console read line, c in, c or text box text, whatever you like. So at the end of the day, we are just going to get n variable index 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. I think you understand. So here with this package, we got all the numbers from the user. So our aim is to add them on top of each other. Simply, I say integer s is equal to 0. What is this for? S is for the sum. And how many numbers do I have? 5. I'm going to again use for statement. For in parentheses, integer again, I starting from 0, I less than 5, I plus plus. And this time, what am I going to do? S is equal to S plus N I. Okay. So we could write S plus equal N I. As you know, these are the same. So what's happening here? We are just calculating the addition of five numbers. So this way, we are adding arrays into S. Is this part clear? So this is how you create an array. This is how you get from the user this array values. And this is how you add these array values into, into S to calculate the sum. And at the end, of course, you can just write S to see the result. Okay? So, this time I'm going to teach you how to use for each. So, as you see here, this is the question. If user enters 5 numbers, this is how we calculate it. Now, I'm going to talk about for each. Very same question, I'm going to do it one more time. So, first of all, integer, I created array, it is an new integer 5. Okay? So then we just calculated now, described now 5 variable and 0 and 1 and 2 and 3 and 4. Okay? So next step, this part is important, pay attention. Generally, we use for each statement for the arrays. Okay, now we learned this a little bit already. For each. Okay. Pay attention. This time, we just use like English word. What is the data type of this n? It is integer. So, for example, I say integer x, something different. In n. So what's happening now? I am writing here simply for each integer x, same type of variable, in n. N is array. So do this. Okay, do this. Do this means for each n. Okay, for each n is going to be assigned as x. So this loop is going to be done 5 times. Okay? So what's going to happen here for each integer x in n? So x means n, in other words. Which n? N0. After that, n1. After that, n2. After that, n3. So it carries on like this and do this. Okay, so this is how you use for each. Inside, now you can use x. So here, you will say read x, for example, xi. For example. All right, what is I? Sorry, I put here, integer I is equal to 0, xi, after that I plus plus. I becomes 1, I becomes 2, I becomes 3. So how many times are you going to do it? How many members do you have in n? Okay, so it's just confused here. I'm going to rewrite this part. Okay, integer I is equal to 0. For each integer x in n, you are going to read xi. I plus plus. So what's happening here? You are just adding I, becoming 1, 2, 3, 4. How many times are you going to do it? N times. Okay? Or, for example, you didn't write anything like I, you would write x. What is x? X is n. N0 will be on screen. N1, N2, N3, N4, all of them will be on screen during this for each loop. Okay? So why are we using array? Because instead of 5, I would say 50. You see? So then normally in the previous way, you would say N1, N2, N3, N50. Okay, this dot 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 cannot be accepted in programming. it should be like properly N4, N5 until 50. But by writing here 50, you created 50 numbers. That's why we are using array. Okay, today at 12:30 we are going to have exercise laboratories, and that's why we will do examples there. So let's pay attention the next part. Do you have any question about array now? If you have, just write text, otherwise I will carry on next step. Okay. So next step, we are going to talk about class. Okay. The keyword for the class is class. So generally I am using the similar class for my lectures. So the keyword is class. So now we are using object-oriented programming to make our program similar to our real life. For example, maybe you may remember in the classroom, I just discussed about the class. Class look like a machine. From this machine, we are just creating objects. Okay, remember this one. So then let me start to create a class. I use a class, for example, this is the keyword I use. And generally for the class names, we are using Pascal notation. Class, I say building, for example. Okay, so after that, I put here parentheses. So here, this structure, class keyword, name of the class building, and this structure, open close parentheses, this is a class. Okay, look at here, there is no parentheses, straight, and starts with capital letter. This is not obligatory, but generally, according to, let's say, software engineers, this is like internal rule. Class should start with the capital letter. So we created a building, and this building class has some properties. Okay, this building class has some properties. What kind of properties do we have? What kind of properties do we have? For example, building has an integer floor. Sorry, floor. So what does it mean? When we create an object from building, when we create an object from the building, we are going to have this building's properties, this building's methods, this building's whatever it has inside. So now it has floor. What does it mean? Every building when we create will have a floor. Okay, for example, if you want to create a five storage building, then this floor information will be 5. If you want to create two storage building, it's going to be 2. Okay, so let's carry on. Buildings have integer area. Okay, so every building has area. Let's say that's all. So pay attention here. This is our building. In other words, this is our machine that we created. Okay, and as you may all know that if you run this piece of program, nothing will happen because there is no main function here. You remember this rule. So when we create our main function, okay, I'm going to just do it now. Main function. And here, first step, this is our machine. Now, from the building is our machine, class is better to use class. From this class, I'm going to create an object. What is the name of object? For example, I would like to create an house. All right, let me create a house. It's very simple. Do you remember how to create a number? We were using integer a, right? Data type, integer a, name of the variable. Now I am doing this. I say building data type and house. What's happening here? I created a house. This is the name of a variable. What is this building? It's the data type of this house. Forget about the previous class. So what you understand here, we are creating a house. What kind of house is this? It is integer? No. It is string? No. It is building. Okay, this is data type. Do you understand what I'm saying? In classroom, I told you already. So this building is not a primitive data type. What kind of data type it is? It is reference data type, which is created by a person here. Class building, I created a data type at the moment. This building has floor, area, maybe something else we are going to see now. This building has floor area. For this kind of building, I created a variable which is house. Question, did I create any object? Answer, there is no object yet. This is just a variable. Just remember, you set integer a. What is a? Is a variable. So it is showing that this a can have any kind of integer number, 4-byte size. And let us talk about house now. House is going to be a building. In other words, house doesn't have any object yet. How am I going to make it? Simply, I will say in the next step, house is equal to, pay attention, here I am creating object, new. All right, this is the new keyword that you are learning. New is used to create an object for variable. So building house, house type is building. House is equal to new building, open close parentheses, it's important. Open close parentheses is important. So then what's happened? What happened now? House is a variable. Now we created an object and we put into house. So this house has an object in as a variable. Okay? Are you with me? Okay. So the next topic, now we are going to combine all of them. Let's just quickly repeat. We created a class, building class. Building should have floor and area. Okay, building should have floor and area. Done. Next step, in our program, this class created by a software engineer for someone, and it is just stated in the program. And next step in our program, I said building house, I'm just creating a house as a variable, and I'm just assigning in that house a new building as an object. So then house has an object at the moment. All right, question, house should have floor and area, right? Because we use building. Okay, is that clear? Because building has floor area, then house should have floor and area. Now let us decide together how many floors this house should be. I'm creating for myself a house, and I say, pay attention here, this is the there is an error here at the moment. House dot floor, house dot floor is equal to 2. What does it mean? I am creating a house, an object. Sorry, actually I created already. And I'm assigning in this house, I have 2 storage. Okay, is that clear? And in this house, the surface area, I mean the area, the land area, is going to, because I like big houses, it is, for example, 150 meters square. Do you understand this part? So in the building new house, I created and a variable, and house is having an object at the moment. For this object, house.floor is 2, house.area is 150. How come house has floor and area? Because we created from the building. Let us look at the building. Here we have floor and area. That's why we put here floor and area. Okay, so maybe some of you knows already. There is an error here. Okay, here there is an error. What kind of error do we have? Because I don't teach you yet, you may not know, or you may know, I don't know. Let's carry on. Here, this is the problem. When you create a class here, when you create a class here, if you use only integer, it is not written anything here, it's not written anything here, but if it is not written anything here, it's written there private. Writing private or not writing private doesn't matter. They are the same. Are you with me? So private means, so you must understand from the name, private means this is private for this class only. You cannot use it somewhere else. So if you look at our program, we are here. This is another program which is using building class. So can I use floor here? I cannot. Why? Because floor here is private for building. How do I understand it's private? Because here nothing is written. Because here nothing is written, this class building inside you can use floor. For example, you can add some codes here and you can use floor here without any problem because it's private for this class. But outside of this class here, house.floor is equal to 2, impossible to say that. Why? Because this floor 2 cannot be equal to 2 because floor is private for the class, not easy to use in main function. So then what are we going to do? We are going to use a keyword here which is called public. Maybe you heard about it and you have seen this one already in the programs, and then you understand what's happening now. Public means you can use this floor anywhere you like. Okay, again here you have to use public. Okay, so then when we come back here, public integer floor, public integer area. So then if you don't write private or if you don't write anything, it's private. So then you cannot use it in another piece of program. If you use public, you can use anywhere you like. So as you see, there is no error at the moment. Why? Because we changed this part, these variables to public. Is that clear? One of you at least say yes or no. Okay, super. So that's why this public, we mustn't forget. Now I'm going to talk about stack and heap. So these are the basic information. After that, we will continue. So now what's happening? We have two storage floor. We have 150 square meter area for our house. House is building. Can I use floor area? Yes, because they are public. Okay, so let's carry on. Now our topic is stack and heap. What is stack and heap? Stack and heap, our new topic here. So for stack and heap, it is not steak, it's very early to eat steak, but stack and heap is the occupation of the memory. Okay, how does it work? So remember our program. What did we write? Pay attention. We said building house, that we said, right? And after that we said house is equal to new building, or immediately we can say new building. Okay, so here stack and heap. Think like this. I'm just going to draw a geometric way. This is our RAM, okay? And RAM is just divided into two parts. So we are going to occupy this house and house information into RAM. So this RAM has two pieces. The first part is stack area. The second part is heap area. You clear, right? You should understand this part properly. It's very important. So let us look at the first part. When you say building house, what are you doing? You are creating a variable, which is house. So this variable is created here. This variable is created here. It is called house. All right? So you must know that the size of this RAM is 1 byte size. Okay. The size of these cells are 1 byte. In other words, when you create building house in 1 byte, here in 1 byte, you created house variable. How many byte is this? 1 byte. But it's not logically true. When we look at back here, remember we use building. We have floor and area in building. And floor is 4 bytes, area is 4 bytes. How do I understand? Because they are integer. Remember this? Okay. Now, because we created house, pay attention, we are using reference. We are using building reference data type. We created house in 1 byte. Is that clear? So pay attention here. When you say new building, you are creating this object. Where is this object created? In heap area. So here is the heap area. Okay. Here is the heap area. In this heap area, we are going to have two pieces. This one is 4 byte. This one is again 4 byte. This one is for floor. This one is for area. Are you with me? Okay, guys, please don't put this A, B, C, whatever it is. If you want to ask some questions, ask me on the text because it's just taking my attention. All right, look at here. What did we do? House is a variable. We created this variable in the stack area, which is 1 byte. And when we say new building, we created an object and it has, as you may remember, floor and area. Okay. And each of them 4 bytes. So as you see here, if you use reference data type, your variable is 1 byte, but your object is whatever byte is. Your object is created in heap area. Is this clear so far? Okay, let us carry on. You must know that maybe you already learned in computer architecture, or maybe you learned somewhere else, doesn't matter. Here, this 4 byte means here there are 4 small cells, each of them 1 byte. Yeah, 1, 2, 3, 4 cells. Here also 1, 2, 3, 4 cells. Okay, so every single cell has an address. For example, 1, 3, FB. This is the address of this point. The next one is 1, 3, FC. These are just example. Okay. So like this, there are addresses here. So for example, if I tell you, can you please show me where is 1, 3, FB address? Here it is. Address is here. So like this, for example, this point I'm talking about, 100. This is the address of this point, okay? Question, what can be the address of this point? 104. Why? Because 100 plus 4 byte, it is 104. What can be address of this point? 108. Okay? So here you can see these are the addresses. I just give as an example this 100, 104, 108, whatever it is. Are you with me? At least give me a sign, plus or minus or whatever it is. I didn't finish yet. Super. Good. Look at here. Let me briefly quickly explain again. House is a variable which has one byte in stack area. And we created new building. We created new building, which is an object in the heap area. And somehow it has an object. It has an address, which is 100. Look at here. When you use assign operator, what is this? You're creating an object, assigning into house. Pay attention here. You created an object, assigning this address into house. Do you understand this area? Now, what's happening? House is equal to 100. What is 100? Address of the object. So then you are pointing this point, this part. So in our program, we said house dot floor is equal to 2. What does it mean? House 100. Go there. Floor. Which one is floor? The first one is equal to 2. I put 2 here. You said house dot area is equal to 150. What's happening here? Where is house? House is 100. 100 is this address. In this address, in this area, we create a big object. In that object, area is in the second part. So then 150 here. So then, did you understand how it is situated in memory? When you create an object, this is very important. I'm going to give you an example now. When you create an object from a reference, variable, reference data type, you are just having this kind of memory stage. Okay, briefly, house is going to be as a variable in stack. New building is going to be as an object in heap area. As an object, whatever this building has, floor, area, how many bytes, so you see these are the sizes. And this has an address, for example, 100. And this 100 is written in house variable because house is a variable, you assign 100. So then when you say house.floor, this 100, floor is here, one, it is 2. So there's 100. Okay, so then Süleymanov, 100 is the address of this this object. Okay, I write here 100. House is not 100 itself. This is address. Address of this part. It's not a value, in other words. It's an address. Okay, Süleymanov. All right. Are you with me here? Did you understand this part, Süleymanov? So, okay. So this 100 is not a value. What is 100 at the end of the table? This is an example of the address of the object. Okay. Address of the object. Okay. Now I'm going to give you an example to be able to understand more properly. Again, we are going to talk about building. So let us remember what was the building. So I'm going to show again here building. So look at here, this is the building that we have. We have public integer floor, we have public integer area. Okay, so this is our building class. We have floor and area. All right. So let us create now in our main function. Now from building, I create a house. Okay. And I say equal to new building. Okay. You know this part. So I created a new object which is called house. All right. Pay attention here. I am creating here from building. This time I'm creating an office. And I say new building. Is this part clear? I created two variables, which are house and office. I created two variables, which are house and office. And each of them has two different objects. One is from building, the other one is also from building. Let me carry on here. House.floor is equal to two storage. House.area is equal to 150. Let us carry on. Office.floor is equal to four storage house. I mean, it's a four storage office. Office.area is equal to 200 meters square, for example. Is that clear? Okay. Now, I will ask you very simple questions. Be careful here. If I say house is equal to office. This is the first thing, something different. Second thing, what am I going to say? If I say office dot floor is equal to 10. Thirdly, if I say write house dot floor. Now question is coming. What am I going to see on the screen? This is the piece of the program. I'm going to give you like a few seconds for you to decide, for you to think. What am I going to see if I want to see floor, how many floor in house, house.floor? Two, good answer. But is it correct or not? I don't know yet. 10, maybe. After one more answer, I'm going to give you the answer. One more person, please. 4. Okay, I got 3 possible options. Very good. 10 or 2. Okay. Can be 2. Can be 4. Can be 10. So then we must just create the logic. Remember that we have to use, because we are using reference data types, so it's not 6, definitely. Reference data type, we have to use stack and heap. Okay? This is very important. Stack and heap. Pay attention. Think about this one logically. So, stack area, we do have, let's see here, in the stack area, we do have house and office, right? Okay, here is the house. I put here house. And after that, in the heap area, we do have a new building for the house, remember? So for the new building, we have 4 bytes, floor and area. Am I right? Remember this one. And again, here, there is an address. What is the address? For example, 100. So when you say house is equal to new building, house is here, new building is here, floor and area, and you are assigning, pay attention, this 100, because you said this object is equal to here. So then I put here 100. Okay. So next step. Okay, Andrei and the other, because it's like, you can just quit if you want to. All right. Say yes or no. I will carry on after that. Andrei. Okay, thank you very much. Let us carry on. So here, this is our heap. This is 100 is written here. So when we just point this 100, what does it say? House floor is equal to 2. House floor is equal to 2. I put 2 here. House area is 150. House area is 150. Okay, I'm carrying on. Oh, here we have a building office. Also, I have here office as a variable. You see? And I created here new building. In other words, I created here another object. It's also 4-4 floor and area, remember this. And let's say this address is 200. So what's going to happen when you say office is equal to new building? So then this time it is pointing the second object, which is 200. So here, when you say office.floor is equal to 4, office 200, floor is equal to 4. Office.area 200, office 200 area is 200. Okay, now we are in this point. Are you with me? Say yes or no. One of you is enough. Okay, so here, house is a variable pointing its object. Office is another variable pointing its object, okay? So let us look at here. It says house is equal to office. House is equal to office. What does it mean? House is here, office is here, and these are the values inside. What are they? These are the address. Look at here. When you say house is equal to office, this part is very tricky part. House is equal to office. So house is equal to office. What does it mean? House becomes 200. Is that clear? Because I said house is equal to office. I didn't say house object is equal to office object. I said house is equal to office. It is here. So then this 100 disappears, 200 appears here. In other words, look at what's happening. House is pointing 200 at the moment. It's not pointing here. Okay, house is pointing 200 because this is address. Is this part clear? Okay, very good. So let us carry on. It didn't finish yet. Now this part. Office.floor is equal to 10. This part is important. Office.floor is equal to 10. So where is office? Office is here. Office is 200. So you go to 200. 200 is here. And in this address, floor is going to change it to 10. So 4 disappears, 10 comes here. Okay, that's what we said. Office.floor is equal to 10. Office.floor is equal to 10. Now question, write house.floor. Let us look at here. What is house? House is 200. 200 is pointing here. Floor? Floor is this one. So what can you see on the screen? Now, is this part clear? So, as you see here, from this point of view, this program looks very simple. Normally, it seems nothing changed for the house floor. Yes, you are right. Nothing changed for the house floor. But because you're putting here, house is equal to office, you are just putting the address of the office into house. That's why when you change office floor, you are changing house floor as well, automatically. So this is how it works in object-oriented programming. Okay. Now I would like to give, if you don't mind, I would like to give like 5 minutes break.